Hello and welcome to Microsoft Mechanics Live. Coming up, we're going to take a look at how you can protect the data in your SaaS apps, as well as access with Cloud App Security, all without getting in the way of your users. And we're going to show you how Cloud App Security can extend Azure Active Directory conditional access controls to your cloud apps, as well as scan and classify files within cloud apps for sensitive information and apply Azure information protection labels that will enforce things like required protection and encryption. Today, I'm going to be joined by Asaf Kashi, the man behind Cloud App Security. Give him a warm welcome.
Thanks, Jeremy. Great to be back.
All right, so for the folks that aren't familiar with Cloud App Security, it's a solution for people that have to discover the applications in their environments. It might be very important in terms of mitigating risks from shadow IT. And once you discover that, it's discovered that the apps that are being used, it also allows you to set policies, detect anomalous behavior, and also protect corporate data within those apps.
That's right.
And those protections are now even stronger that we've integrated with Azure Active Directory, right?
That's right. Cloud application security is great for gaining visibility and control over your cloud applications in use in your organization. We're now extending Azure AD conditional access, which we all love, to allow you to limit access to your specific SaaS applications directly within the user session itself. This functionality is going to build on the robust conditions that we have in Azure Active Directory conditional access, such as device type, whether or not you're accessing it from a trusted location, and user risk levels, as well as all of the other conditions.
So before we get started, can we check out the experience for a user and then look at how it's configured?
Yeah. So let's take a look at this. So we'll start with a demo for two users and two applications. So we're going to go into Salesforce. And we're going to log in using the Asaf user right here. And as long as I remember my password.
It's always important to remember the password.
Always remember the password. All right, and what is showing on the screen is the fact that I've configured my demo machine to work in two modes. One, where by default, it's an unmanaged machine. It doesn't belong to this particular demo tenant, et cetera. But in this case, I'm being prompted for the certificate. And if I click OK, I'm impersonating a managed machine. I'm basically saying, yes, I have the certificate. This machine is a good corporate machine. So what happened here is the user went straight through to Salesforce. And what you're seeing is this particular Salesforce instance. I can browse around, I can get my files, et cetera, and the URL is the salesforce.com URL. Now, let's do this so everything works in that one. So now, let's take the same demo, and we're going to start again with Salesforce and log in, but not submit that certificate, and we're going to see what's going to happen in this case. So again, this time a little bit quicker, and we're going to log in again. And I'm prompted again for the certificate. I'm hitting cancel. Now, what's happening immediately, you can see that between Salesforce and Azure Active Directory, I got redirected to the proxy where access to Salesforce being monitored is being displayed to the end user. Okay. I'm still going to continue, and I'm going to get the same experience from an end user perspective because we're only monitoring, but the URL that you're seeing already is .cas.ms. So again, Cloud App Security is now in the middle here, proxying all the activities of the user. And later on, we can take a look at what the admin can see from that experience. Again, I can click on files. I can do whatever I need to do in Salesforce. I'm not blocked from doing anything.
Right.
So that was our first demo for Salesforce. Let's go to the second demo here. And this is going to be over on Box, because again, we wanted to show you two different applications. I'll start with an incognito tab here. I'm going to go to my Box account, and I'll use a different user in this case.
Okay.
So again, this is configured for single sign-on, standard Azure Active Directory functionality. And by logging into this as Sylvia, I'm going to see what happens when I want to protect or to block. So let me type my password again. There are a lot of passwords in these demos.
Yeah, it's a common way.
Yes. So I'm going to cancel because this is an unmanaged machine. I'm not submitting a certificate. Again, we see the same thing, access to Box is monitored. So you saw me proxying Salesforce, proxying Box, non-Microsoft applications. This works for any SAML application.
Importantly, we're informing the user that they're being monitored, and then they can kind of see it through the URL and the address bar up top.
Correct. And if the organization doesn't want to do this, they don't have to. So okay. In this case, I'm going to start by taking the day-to-day work info file here, and I'm just going to download that straight to my local machine. So again, I imagine this being the unmanaged machine. I'm in a customer site. I'm working from home. I'm not domain joined. The file downloaded in this case, and I'm going to click and open that. And what you're seeing is Word is opening the file locally. I saw some signs for Azure Information Protection already loading up. And what you can see here is that if I look at the permissions, this file is authenticated to Contoso, which happens to be this particular tenant, and it is locked down to view only. So what I did was, because it's an unmanaged machine, I protected this with Azure Information Protection. The user didn't have to take any actions. Nothing happened for them other than download the file, open it, and they're doing the right thing for the business.
Very cool.
So let's take a look at that third and final demo for the user. We're going to now take the confidential file. So this file happens to be tagged as a confidential. So it's labeled with Azure Information Protection.
Right.
And I'm going to try to download this the same exact way. Now what you're seeing here is, since this is a confidential file and I've accessed this as an unmanaged machine, the policy here is saying this is restricted. So we're just blocking this. You can see that particular information came up for the user. This is again configured. And not only that, we allowed the user to download a breadcrumb. And in this case, it's a little text file that shows all of the information in case I ever have to go back and talk from a support person's perspective, or if the user says, no, this actually should have worked. Let me figure out why. Right. So we help you troubleshoot in case of emergency.
Very cool. So I would have thought that you could basically only gate access and authorization at the site level for these types of services. We've just shown Box and Salesforce. How did you control the actions to actually protect the contents and the actions people take against the contents themselves?
Right. So for the user, they're just navigating to the app. As you can see on the screen, their experience is straightforward. Everything is, as long as they're authorized, it just works, just like we saw in that first Salesforce examples. So behind the scenes, we configured Azure Active Directory single sign-on for the SAML 2.0 application that we had that we wanted to apply these session controls for. And then we follow that with the full conditional access policy in Azure Active Directory that is going to point to Cloud App Security, where we're configuring which action we want to take. So this particular chain is, as you see on the screen, going from the user to the application to Azure Active Directory to conditional to Cloud App Security. So then finally, once all of these policies run, the user is now interacting with the application directly through the Cloud App Security proxy. So in this case, both Azure Active Directory as well as the Cloud App Security policies all get out of the way, and it's straightforward right through the Cloud App Security proxy.
Really cool. How did we actually get all this up and running? How did we configure it?
So in this case, we're going to log in as the admin for this particular tenant. And what we're going to take a look is the Azure Active Directory blade. And we're going to take a look at the enterprise app. So if I look at enterprise applications here, and remember, we were doing single sign-on with Box and Salesforce. So let's take a look at Box. I'm going to click on that and look at the properties. And what you're going to see here are all the settings that you've used if you've ever configured Azure Active Directory single sign-on with a SAML app. You'll see that basically these are the access URLs, the application ID. So this is all standard stuff for someone who's done that.
So that's basically redirecting the access and authentication steps to go through Azure AD.
That's right. So Box knows to go over to to Azure Active Directory for access. Now, we're going to click on the conditional access. And this is basically a shortcut that shows me the policies that are applying to this particular application. So Route Sylvia to Kaz was one of the names of those. And we're going to take a look at it. This is in the conditional access part of the Azure Active Directory configuration. Mm-hmm. And what you're seeing here are two sections. One are the conditions or assignments. And the other one is the access controls. So if I look at the assignments, they're pretty simple for this demo policy here. I've configured it for Sylvia. I've checked which application. So Box was the one in question. And I've enabled the session proxy. So all I had to do was check this box, and it allows me to redirect to Cloud App Security.
So basically what we've done here is we've configured our app effectively, or our set of apps, to talk to Azure AD for authentication. We've then set up all the Azure AD controls and conditional access. Now it's on to Cloud App Security and that console to be able to configure the rest we need to do in terms of all the activities that we're going to monitor and block or let happen.
Exactly. So in here, you can see that I have three session policy policies in this case. And I'm going to click on, let's take the block one.
Okay.
So I'm going to actually take a look at the settings for that right here and walk you right through this. So what you're going to see, we're monitoring the activities. In this particular case, we looked for a specific user because we wanted, again, for a demo policy, you can configure any Azure Active Directory group or usernames.
Right, we're picking on Sylvia here, but it could be the entire marketing team or the entire research and development team.
That's right, usually the finance and legal teams are my suspects, but
right.
You can use whoever you'd like. In this case, we've looked for a device that does not have a valid client certificate or is compliant or is domain joined. So remember, when I submitted the client certificate, it worked without this policy. When I didn't, it basically redirected me through here.
Right.
And then I made sure that it wasn't, or it was a confidential file. So in this case, the label is equal to a confidential file. Mm-hmm. And then I took the action of blocking. And then right in the block action, you can see that the particular message is configurable right here. And you can choose whether or not that message comes up or not at all for this particular user. You can also send emails, you can send alerts, etc. And before we move forward, I wanted to show one other thing in here. So remember how I mentioned the admin might be able to see all of this. This is where investigating the activity log will show you in real time all of the actions that I just took. So this is not something that happened before. You can see by the timestamps. You can see by the IP addresses. These are items that happened right now. So you can see that Sylvia here was redirected to the proxy. There was a log on. There was a downloaded file that was protected. And then there was a confidential file that was blocked. So again, every one of the actions that happened is being logged. And if I scrolled further back, you would see that the Asaf user was only monitored. Again, but we don't want to go through every line item here, but you can see this is all in Cloud App Security, and it's all available for you to export to whatever SIEM or ticketing system you have.
Right, so what do I have to do in terms of getting some of the information protection controls up and running that we saw earlier, like when you had the AIP bar on the top of the document?
Right, so you've heard of the information, Microsoft's information protection solution all up. So we're leveraging all of those capability in Cloud App Security where we can scan, we can classify and label all your content, including applying encryption automatically to files. So since I've already showed you the user experience, we're going to start here from the admin experience. And in the past, I think maybe even in a previous session with you, I've shown you the fact that I can do manual encryption. So
right.
if I go into the file log here and find a file that isn't already encrypted, I can just click on these three boxes and apply a classification label. This is something we used to be able to do, you know, from day one or from a while back.
So I'll do all that then directly through transport as it goes into the service, or how's that working?
So in this case, we would apply the classification label in Cloud App Security, and based on the Azure Information Protection mapping of that label to protection and encryption, it would apply that in whatever file repository it is. So
Very
if
cool.
a user uploads a file, we see it here, we can apply it manually. But when we want to do this automatically, we can go over to our policies and directly apply that. So let's take a look at that other protection policy, because it'll give us an example of this. And if I click on the settings here, we'll be able to look at this, where I'll scroll straight to the bottom, and you can see, instead of blocking in this one, all we had to do was check the box that says protect,
mm-hmm.
and these labels are coming straight from Azure Information Protection. So this policy, whether I apply it at the proxy layer, at conditional access, or I apply it at the file upload layer, this is the same kind of policy that you could use to automatically encrypt files that are uploaded to Box, if they're sensitive, or uploaded to OneDrive, or any of the G Suite applications. Again,
Very
this
cool.
is Cloud App Security applying Azure Information Protection labels automatically.
So amazing. So you've been able to protect files that are outside of the fabric of Microsoft Cloud. That protection then is extending to other third-party services. In this case, we saw Box and Salesforce. But I'm sure you can do more than this, right?
Yeah. So let's take a look at what we're announcing this week.
Sure.
On how people can easily get started. So what we're going to do here, I've got one final demo that I wanted to show here. And we're going to log into a completely new Cloud App Security tenant. And this one is going to demonstrate our discovery. So what we've done is we've taken our discovery functionality, and we had a couple of different discovery solutions out there. We had the Azure Cloud App Discovery in Azure Active Directory, and we had the discovery solution from Cloud App Security. What we're doing is we're taking the discovery solution from Cloud App, from Cloud Application Security, and we're giving it to those tenants that have Cloud App Discovery. Specifically, everyone that has EMS E3 licenses will now get our discovery solution. So let me show you how this works.
Great. So anybody with E3 can use this, and it's going to go out and discover the apps that are being used. How's the design of this work in terms of prerequisites? Anything to do?
No. So anybody that has EMS E3, if you've got a new tenant today, it will already get this discovery application. You don't need to go to E5 purely for discovery. Obviously, if you want the full functionality of Cloud App Security and you want to take action on all of the discovered applications, you will need to go to the premium SKU of E5. But as I've logged in here, your tenant, as an E3 tenant, it looks exactly like the discovery page that we have over in the full Cloud App Security. But the investigation, you notice that we only have the custom reports. For controls, policies, and templates, we're very focused just on discovery. Now, the one thing that we don't put in the E3 solution is the risks. So as you start going down to risk detail, it will prompt you to go to the E5 solution or the standalone CAS license.
Very, very cool. So everybody should be trying Cloud App Security today using the discovery now that's part of basically any E3 and above tenant. Very, very cool stuff that you've shown today. Where would you recommend, aside from going to cloudappsecurity.com, where should people get started?
Yeah, so obviously you can go to cloudappsecurity.com to sign up for a trial or to add it to an existing tenant. Our conditional access enhancement for limited session are coming this coming month.
Very cool. Awesome set of technologies protecting the apps and services outside of the Microsoft fabric. So very, very cool stuff. How to get that all configured. That's all the time we have for this show. Thanks for joining us, Asaf. Of course, you can stay up to date with all the latest tech and Microsoft mechanics. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.